Good afternoon, everybody. And I, on behalf of ISCCM, welcome you all to this next episode of Step N, which is our structured training and education program for our nurses, primarily connected with the critical care services in the country. Today's topic is sedation and analgesia in the ICU. Sedation and analgesia is probably one of the most commonly performed procedure or intervention that is practiced in ICU almost always on all the patients. But unfortunately, it is one of the least discussed topic regarding about something that you practice almost every day. So today we have a senior consultant with us, Dr. Srikant Sastrabuddhay. He'll be taking you through the details of sedation, analgesia, who are the patients who need it, how should we monitor sedation and analgesia, and what are the complications, when should we stop, and every small nitty-gritty he'll run you through. Dr. Srikant is a director of pulmonology and critical care at Medicover Hospital, Aurangabad. While Dr. Srikant is talking about it, if you have any questions, you can write in the chat box. And together we'll make sure that your questions are being answered at the end after his talk. Okay, so over to you, Dr. Srikant, and thank you very much. Dr. Srikant, can you hear me?
Thank you very much. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Yeah. So I'll start now.
Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah. So should I start now to take a, you know, talk on sedation, especially in the afternoon the meals? So I welcome you all for this afternoon session on sedation and analgesia in ICU. I thank ISCCM for the opportunity and Dr. Vijay for the kind introduction. In another 35 to 40 minutes, I would like to discuss the various aspects of sedation and analgesia in the ICU, especially from the nurse's point of view. And I will try to make it as simple as possible. Although there are few terminologies and few concepts which are, which will have a little complicated slides, which I will just try to kind of narrate. So, now talking about sedation, why anyone will need analgesia or sedation in ICU? They will need it mainly for pain, for the sleep deprivation, and mainly because of the presence of the various tubes in the nose and mouth, which is, very, very simple to understand that why do they need sedation or analgesia when the patient is in ICU. So let us start with a case so that we can actually understand the dynamics and the intricacies of the subject. So this is a 55 years old male who is a known case of diabetes, hypertension, COPD.
So sorry to disturb, ischemic heart disease. But we cannot see the slides, sir.
Oh. You can see me?
See you, sir.
You can see me, right?
Yes, Dr. Srikant, we can see you, but your slide is not being shared.
Now let me just try again. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sorry for that. So basically, we are looking for a patient who is around 55-year-old male, having multiple comorbidities in the form of. Just a second. Give me a second, please. Now is it audible? I mean, now is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is a case of diabetes, hypertension, COPD, ischemic heart disease, obesity. And this patient came with a history of fever, cough, dyspnea, restlessness. And the patient is suggestive of having hypoxia, as you could clearly see, that with a saturation of 78% on room air. The patient is put on venturi mask 40%, and the patient is with Foley catheter. So this is so this is the case scenario, and here we are basically looking for. Don't go into the details of the diagnosis, and you know what do we want to actually diagnose the patient and things like that. Here we basically want to know that what is this particular condition called as. The patient is not keeping oxygen mask. The patient is irritable. What is this called as? As we know that it is called as delirium. So I think these are the, you know, this is one the MCQ which I want to put in. And, you know, you can actually share the answers. So what are the predisposing factors for delirium or anxiety in ICU? Are acute medical or surgical condition, underlying medical conditions, ICU environmental influences, or medications, or the option is all of the above. So you can answer on the chat box. I think these are the MCQs which are, you know, clinically very important. And I don't think it is very difficult. The answer is very clear. It is all of the above. So coming back to, you know, anxiety, pain and delirium, these are the different factors responsible for the same, including the acute medical or surgical illnesses, the underlying medical conditions, mechanical ventilation, the invasive procedures, medications, and of course the ICU environment. And herein we actually try to intervene in the form of, you know, correction of the causative factors, or you give them sedative or analgesia or antipsychotic medications. And as you could see that there is a spectrum from dangerous agitation to unresponsiveness. So this is a spectrum of different neurological or confusional states, right from dangerous agitation to unresponsiveness. So we obviously want to avoid that. And here is something called as a CAM-ICU method of assessment of confusional state in ICU, where it is called as a CAM-ICU. The feature one is to look for acute onset of changes or fluctuation in the course of mental status, and of course, inattention. So if either of this is present with a disorganized thinking or altered level of consciousness, you diagnose these patients of having delirium. So that is very important. This slide is very important. And another MCQ follows this slide is, as you could see that there's a changes in RAS or Glasgow Coma Scale. And this, where it is less than 8 correct answers on the visual or auditory questionnaire, you will find that more than 3 to 4 wrong answers, we are unable to follow commands. And the altered level of consciousness, whether it is alertness, you know, ranging from alertness to a comatose condition. So It is a little busy slide, but I think you can just remember that CAM ICU is a method of assessment of confusion or delirium in ICU. And as you could see, that delirium, which is acute onset, it has rapid fluctuations, and it is associated with impaired cognitive functions, where there is ability to receive, process, store, and recall. Everything is lost, and the patient is agitated or lethargic. So there can be delirium of two types. It could be either hypoactive delirium or hyperactive delirium. So why do we worry about delirium? Because, you know, any patient who is irritable or who is not in his senses, it is a sign of serious underlying disorder. It is an independent risk factor for mortality, and it is responsible for longer hospital stay. It is associated with impaired cognitive functions at discharge, and it is often iatrogenic or a preventable. So that is very important. Whether you are giving any drug, whether you know, there is any underlying sepsis, whether you have the underlying neurological disorders. So these are responsible for delirium. Any patient who becomes rowdy in the ICU is not that patient's fault. It is probably we who are failing to understand what the patient has. So now these are a few of the guidelines. This is the SACM pain, agitation, and delirium guideline. And I just want you to focus on something called as a critical care pain observation tool, that is called as a CPOT, and we'll just come to that. This is the critical care pain observation tool, which includes the facial expression, and we have a scoring system on that. We have a facial expression, body movements, muscle tension, and ventilator compliance or vocalization. So these are the four points on which the CPOT scoring is based on. Another thing, the practice guidelines say that IV opioids is the first line drug of choice to treat the non-neutropathic patient in critically. So opioid analgesics as well as the IV medications which we give most commonly would be fentanyl in ICU, which is to be used in the form of opioid. So as I said, the CAM ICU, this is the most valid and reliable delirium monitoring tool. And there are different strategies like what has been mentioned here, but I think important thing is to remember that the CAM ICU is the valid and a reliable delirium monitoring tool. And this is another MCQ that which is the for the assessment of confusion in ICU, it is done by which of the following methods? Is it RAS or SOFA scoring or CAM ICU or GCS? What is it? No, I just said the answer, that is CAM ICU. Okay, that is confusion assessment method in ICU. Okay, so the same patient who becomes more tachypneic, the patient becomes desaturation. There is a desaturation. Patient becomes drowsy but is arousable. The patient is put on NIV, although he doesn't respond to that. He becomes more drowsy. And we give him sedation, which is used as a pre-medication before intubation, and the patient is intubated and mechanically ventilated. So this is a very common scenario in any ICU. Patient who is on NIV doesn't respond, you sedate the patient and intubate the patient. Okay, so this is the clinical diagnosis is probably the acute exacerbation of COPD. So another question is, which of these sedatives have rapid onset of action and is short acting? Is it fentanyl or lorazepam or midazolam or dexmedetomidine? I think again, you can keep on answering on your chat boxes. We will see how have you responded or how correct you are. So here obvious answer is, what is the answer is midazolam, okay? Midazolam is the one with rapid onset of action and short acting. Okay. So another question here is, what is the need for sedation in ICU? Is it for humane reasons or to facilitate mechanical ventilation or to reduce the intracranial hypertension in IC bleeds and trauma patients, or to relieve the pain, or as a form of palliative care. So this is a MCQ, and the sixth option is all of the above. So the obvious answer is all of the above, correct. So now I think talking about sedation, which is used for stressful environment, especially in ICU, where you have fear or anxiety, or the patient actually expresses that they are helpless, either because of severe illness, and there is always a doubt of whether they will be, whether they will survive. There is separation from family, and these days in COVID era, we are actually experiencing it, very often, that the patient says that I want to meet my family members, I want to meet my father, brother, wife, whatever it is. And of course, related to the deranged sleep and the noise which is happening in ICU, no ICU on this earth can be without noise. You have alarms, you have ventilator alarms, and you have so many stressful situations there. So role of sedatives is just, a few points which I want you to remember is, remember that benzodiazepines are the very common drugs which are used for sedation. Like, as I said, midazolam. The other one is lorazepam, which can be an independent risk factor for transitioning to delirium. So be careful when you use lorazepam. Another drug which is used is dexmedetomidine, which is an alpha 2 agonist, which causes less delirium than midazolam or propofol. So we have an advantage of using dexmedetomidine because it will cause less delirium than midazolam. So amongst benzodiazepines and dexmedetomidine, benzodiazepine group can cause more delirium. Talking about sedation, either it will cause amnesia or hypnosis and anxiolysis. And here you have, as I said, benzodiazepines, as we very commonly use midazolams or lorazepams, or sometimes we use propofol. Okay. Now talking about analgesia, you have opioids, where you are looking for respiratory depression and antitussive effect of the drugs. So in short, I think you can very easily see this slide where midazolam, as I said, the advantages are rapid action and short acting. The disadvantages that there are a lot of drug interactions. Lorazepam, which is cheaper but longer half-life. You have propofol, which is rapid onset or short acting, but it may cause hypotension, and it will actually cause increase in serum triglyceride. As you could see, that propofol, which is visibly seen as a white colored agent, which looks like a milk. Okay. So it has an excellent agent for the short term sedation, and it is especially used for neurological or neurosurgical patients. So remember that if the patient is of trauma and you want to decrease the intracranial pressure, we will use propofol. Otherwise, we are using benzodiazepines. Okay. So these are opioid analgesics or opioid agents, mainly the morphine, fentanyl, and remifentanyl. And here we usually use, whenever we use, we may use fentanyl, which has rapid onset of action and less hypotension than morphine. So the same patient here was intubated and ventilated, as I told you. And as a standard ICU care, this patient was inserted with central line and arterial line. This patient was also inserted with NG tube, that is commonly called as Ryle's tube. And the patient was sedated and paralyzed with all the supportive care which was on. And as per the protocol of the different hospitals, this patient was started on midazolam infusion. Now, why we use midazolam or sedation infusions? Mainly when the patient is mechanically ventilated, we need to have facilitation of mechanical ventilation. So you need to have control of anxiety. The patient should not get agitated or remove his tubes, the RT or the endotracheal tube. They should be able to tolerate endotracheal tube. You should prevent self-extubations and it actually reduces the respiratory drive and the cough, and of course helps to alleviate dyspnea. Of course, there is also added advantage of therapeutic intracranial hypertension when it can actually decrease that. So you need to actually tailor the patient's requirement, and not that every dose is same for every patient. We need to assess the degree of sedation between the two different patients and also give sedation for procedures. If the patient is for central line or nasogastric tube or maybe a pleural tapping or ascites tapping, we need to actually sedate this patient. And as we know, what causes pain in ICU is surgery, trauma, pre-existing diseases, invasive procedures, routine nursing care like suctioning or dressing and immobilization, and all these things can cause pain, and we need drugs for that. So either we give intermittent doses that, you know, if the patient needs 5 milligrams of midazolam, you give, then again after 1 hour you give, repeat the dose, or you give infusion. So there can be two different strategies of delivering sedatives to the patient. Either it could be in a bolus form or in an infusion form, and we'll see the differences. So just to add upon dexmedetomidine as one of the drug, and as you should know as a nurse, what is dexmedetomidine, and there are a few, you know, descriptive you know, facts which are given here, that it is mainly alpha 2 agonist. It is used for sedation and anxiolysis. It also has an analgesic effect. So the benefit of dexmedetomidine is that it is sedative as well as analgesic. Okay. So it's a painkiller plus sedative. And so another MCQ here is, which is the sedative agent which can cause increase in the serum triglyceride level? Okay. Whether it is dexmedetomidine or it is propofol or it is midazolam or fentanyl. What do you think? You can just again write it in the chat box. But the answer here is, if you have seen the slides carefully, I have said that propofol can increase the serum triglyceride level. And you can remember this because propofol is white in color. Okay. So it can increase the serum triglyceride, that is fat in the body. Okay. Now dexmedetomidine, the site of actions, mainly it can cause, you know, have autonomic, affection on the autonomic nervous system also. So it will decrease the heart rate and it can actually cause hypotension. So this is the comparative study, and I will not go into the details, but then this is the effect of sedation with dexmedetomidine versus lorazepam in acute brain dysfunction in mechanically ventilated patient. And as we know that dexmedetomidine actually resulted in more days alive without delirium or coma. So remember that dexmedetomidine is an agent which can cause less delirium than benzodiazepines. Okay. And our target is to keep the patient pain-free with a good comfort and not painful coma. You don't want to make them comatose. You don't want to make them unconscious, but we want to make them comfortable wherein they are pain-free. Okay. So now these are the current ICU sedation therapies. As you could see, midazolam, propofol, opioids and dexmedetomidine. And these are the different parameters. On the left side, as you could see, that how they act. So here you have prolonged weaning and the respiratory depression. Cumulative. I think the points which you can remember here is that the midazolam, if you look at midazolam, you know, it has amnesia, and dexmedetomidine, where it is clearly that they don't have amnesia and delirium potential. Respiratory depression is not caused by dexmedetomidine. So a patient who is weaning, or the patient who is, you know, you want to extubate the patient, you can give dexmedetomidine because there is no respiratory depression. So remember, these are the important points in this slide. So dexmedetomidine doesn't have delirium potential, but and it also doesn't depresses the respiratory center. So these are the advantages of dexmedetomidine. Now, as I said, any drug in ICU needs titration. Either it could be inotrope or it could be a vasodilator. So similarly, it could be a sedation. You need to titration for the same. So So these are few scales, and this is a Ramsey scale, which we need to actually remember that level 1 to 5, and you could see that 1 being more agitation or agitated patient, and 5 being more sleepy patient. So 1 is patient is rowdy and agitated, and 5 is the patient with a sluggish response. So 2, 3, and 4, these are the things which we need to actually target for, that the patient should be between 2 and 3 or 3 and 4. Okay, patient should not be too much rowdy also, and the patient should not be too much sleepy also. Okay, so now this is another scale which is also called as Richmond agitation sedation scale, and you could see that the plus points are towards more agitation in the red, and the minus points are more towards drowsiness in the green. And any time when this RAS score is more than 3, you need to actually go and assess the CAM ICU. So this is a patient focused approach, that the patient is the main focus. You need to select the analgesic and sedative drugs based on the patient's need rather than what you think. Degree of sedation and anxiolysis, which may vary between two patients, sometimes in the same patients over the period of time. So you need less sedation or less, anxiolysis during the weaning periods, and you will need it more during the procedural times. So first you have to focus on analgesia and then the sedation. So this is important, that first they should be pain-free and then they should sleep. Okay. Not that you sleep them, make them sleep and then give analgesia. So this sequence is important. So first you make them pain-free and then give them sedation. So this is just about surviving sepsis guidelines 2016, which talks about limitation of the use of sedation, which will reduce the duration of mechanical ventilation and hospital length of stay. As we all know, that if the patient is less sleepy, the patient can go home early. Okay. DSI stands for daily sedation interruption, where if the patient is on infusion, if the patient is on sedation and infusion of the sedation, you need to actually daily interrupt these sedation infusions every day in the morning. And we will see one or two trials on that. So this is a wake up and breathe protocol, that you can see there is initiation of mechanical ventilation. There is something called as SAT safety screen, that is a spontaneous awake trial. So it is spontaneous awake trial. That means you see whether the patient is awake or not. Then if the patient passes this, you perform a spontaneous awake trial. If the patient passes this, then you give spontaneous breathing trial. Okay, that is TPs, that we, daily we see in COVID ICUs also, or in medical ICU also, where you actually see how we give spontaneous breathing trials to this patient. You perform the spontaneous breathing trial, and if they pass that, then you extubate the patient. Okay, so first you see whether the patient is awake and then give them TPS trial, not when the patient is drowsy or not awake. Okay, so this is daily interrupted sedation in mechanically ventilated patient, and there is one paper which tells about that the daily interruption was associated with a higher mean daily doses of midazolam and fentanyl. So whether the daily interruption is really useful or not is a point to think about. Now this is something called as a ABCDE bundle for back end of the critical care. Means you talk of intubation, front end is you talk of intubation, you talk of resuscitation, you talk of mechanical ventilation, you talk of broad spectrum antibiotics, you talk of inotropes, you talk of procedures. So this is a front end when the patient comes to the ICU. Here we are talking of the back end. That means whether the patient is awake, whether the patient is breathing, or with a coordination and of the daily sedation and ventilator removing trials, whether the patient is tolerating SBT or the patient has delirium, and early mobility and exercise. So early mobilization of these patients are very important. Not that it is only medicine, not that it is only sedation, not that it is only antibiotics. It is mainly to see whether the patient can get mobilized as early as possible. And we try to do that in our ICUs on daily basis. Even if the patient is ventilated or on non-invasive ventilator, you can actually mobilize this patient. And we have done that in our, you know, respective ICUs in various places. So now someone who has read that slide carefully can answer this question. What does the letter D stands for in the ABCD bundle for the back end of the critical care? Options are disability, defibrillation, deformity, or delirium. What is the answer for this? I think it is clearly, this is the slide. So this is delirium. Okay. So the answer is delirium. As you could see, you know, this is a, you know, this is a photograph of a Western ICU where I'm sure in all our Indian ICUs and with the help of the nurses like you, we are able to help the patients. We are able to mobilize them. It's not that the patient is mechanically ventilated means he has to be on the bed. No, it is not like that. In fact, because he's on mechanical ventilator, you have to mobilize him. Otherwise, if this is a moving patient, the patient can themselves move. They don't need any help. Okay. So try to make sure that you mobilize this patient. And this is one of the important ABCDE component of the back end of the critical care. This is again the PAD guideline. And here, I think you need to remember the second point. Remember the second point, that is Richmond agitation sedation scale and sedation agitation scale are the most valid and reliable sedation assessment tools. So you have to actually assess the sedation, correct? So first, you have actually, you know the concept of sedation. First, you know the concept of delirium. Okay, what is confusion in ICU means? You know how to monitor those deliriums. Then you come to in which patient you need sedation and which sedation. Okay, then you put the patient on mechanical ventilator. Remember, you have to give analgesia first and then sedation. Then you think over whether you need bolus doses of sedation or infusion of sedation. And then you have to actually monitor the patient on sedation. So this is the scale which is used to assess the sedation of the patient. Okay. Here I want you to remember that analgesia first sedation, which is to be always used in mechanically ventilated patient, and early mobilization wherever is possible. Okay. So this decision is taken by a clinical team. It is not taken as a, you know, it is not as a individual decision. It is taken by the consultant, the doctor on duty, the intensivist, the RMO, the junior nurse, the senior nurse, sister in charge, and every one of us discuss and then decide whether this patient can be mobilized. So the initial era was of the paralysis, that if you see a moving patient, just give them vecuronium or sesatracurium and paralyze them. No, it is probably not correct. The second era was you just sedate them and make them unconscious. So they are comatose. Again, this may not be correct. The third era was to give patients what they need. So if the patient needs analgesia or if the patient needs sedation, and now it is analgesia and also to avoid delirium. So make sure that the patient doesn't become rowdy, the patient doesn't remove the lines, the patient doesn't become, irritable. So this was the last question, I think. I just thought in a lighter mood, which is the best sedation in ICU is either midazolam, propofol, dexmedetomidine, or my talk. I'm sure the fourth answer is not correct. And I would like to thank all of you for attention. And I tried to be as brief as possible. I tried to be as descriptive as possible. And we are open for question and answers. I will be happy to take questions. Thank you very much.
So they need to drop their questions in the chat box.
Dr. Srikant, that was very useful. We have a question.
Yeah.
from one of our participants, which says, which scenario paralytics are required?
Right. So the question is, in which scenario the paralytics are required? As we know, yes, that the patient who is requiring mechanical ventilation, and we have intubated the patient and mechanically ventilated the patient, wherein we don't want a too much of respiratory drive or too much of work of breathing, where the respiratory muscles are overworked and they are more fatigued. So you have actually decided to give the mechanical ventilation to this patient to put these muscles into rest. So after the sedation, whatever the choice you have, either a midazolam or a propofol or a fentanyl or dexmedetomidine, for initial 24 to 48 hours, there are studies, especially for ARDS patients. There's a famous NEJM paper which talks about cis-tetracurium for initial 24 to 48 hours, which will actually has survival benefits in this patient. And we need to paralyze this patient for initial 48 and 72 hours, but not after that, preferably not after 72 hours.
So to summarize what you're saying, Dr. Srikant, for my nursing colleagues, so basically when we are starting ventilation for the first time, that's the time you would require in most of the cases.
Yes.
And also when ventilation is difficult, with only with sedation.
Yes, I think so. Okay. Perfect.
Then we have again a question from a colleague called Dhruv. Irritable and non-compliant patient on non-rebreathing mask, which is a sedative safe to use and to avoid intubation and to make the patient more comfortable and compliant? So you have a delirious patient on NRBM. His question is, which is a safe sedative? I think you discussed this, right?
Yes. But anyways, I think I'll just put it, because as we know that benzodiazepines have a delirium potential. So for as a standard, I don't think benzodiazepine can be the option for this. Dexmedetomidine would be the drug of choice. And in few scenarios, we can actually prefer, even though it is a little old molecule, but haloperidol can also be used. In few situations, we can actually try lorazepam, which has a little less delirium potential than midazolam. But essentially, dexmedetomidine can be used safely in this patient.
So what are the safety measures we should be concerned about when we are using dexmedetomidine? Something that I would want to like and for my colleagues to know.
Right. So as we just saw that the mechanism of actions of dexmedetomidine is alpha agonist. And it the site of action of dexmedetomidine is locus coeruleus. It also acts on the spinal cord. So there are two actually actions, as I said, that it is analgesic as well as sedative. The major things which we need to look at the bedside is bradycardia and hypotension. These are the two basic things. Although the advantage is that it obviously doesn't depresses the respiratory center. So we can actually safely use for the patients who can actually can get off avoiding intubations in this patient.
So yeah, so that bradycardia and
low blood pressure
and hypotension is something that we need to look for whenever we are using dexmedetomidine.
Correct.
And also, because dexmedetomidine, you have to give a loading dose and then a maintenance dose.
Yes.
So it becomes really significant.
Yes.
When you load them, then the pressures can drop. You can go into bradycardia.
Right.
Okay. One of our colleagues is asking, can we use ketamine in ICU setup?
Yes, definitely ketamine can be used in especially in patients where you want to have a awake kind of intubation. If it is a difficult intubation, especially patients having bronchoconstriction, but we need to make sure that the performer or the person who is intubating is a specialist, and you can definitely use ketamine for assistance of a so-called difficult intubation, for relaxation of the muscles or the oropharyngeal muscles where the intubation becomes easy. But it has to be used under guidance and supervision.
Then one more thing that I would want to add regarding ketamine. Well, you see, essentially the ketamine has gone out of fashion.
Yeah.
Right. It's very rarely used.
Yes.
And one of the few reasons have been, yes, it was a wonderful drug at one point of time, but it's got so many side effects.
Side effects, yes.
That today in ICU setups, you'd preferably only use it when you have a very unstable, hemodynamically unstable patient. That's the time you would use, and maybe for some procedures, putting a cast or relocating or reducing the fractures in ICU. That's probably the only indication. And as Dr. Srikanth said, is that potassium interrelate with succinylcholine? Yeah, this is everybody should know this.
So it is usually it is a known fact that succinylcholine can cause hyperkalemia. So in any patient who is a prior kidney failure patient, or the patient who is known to have hyperkalemia or any drug induced potassium related issues, you need to be very careful while using succinylcholine, because it can certainly cause hyperkalemia. Hello?
Yes, Dr. Srikanth.
Yeah. So, do I read the Dr. Vijay?
Yes, sorry, ma'am. I had to take an important call.
Okay, fine.
So I don't see any more new questions. Yes, it is extremely important to get your sedation and analgesia right in an ICU setup to have the best patient outcomes, both in terms of early weaning of mechanical ventilation, early recovery, a more alert patient, and avoidance of the delirium that Dr. Srikanth mentioned. We have one question from a colleague saying, considering the chance of histamine release, still atracurium is very abundantly used in COVID-19 patients. What could be the reason for it? Can you think of something, Dr. Srikanth?
Yeah, I think, the choice of paralyzing agents, again, is a topic by itself. There are different issues related to different geographical areas, if I can say so. The availability issues of certain drugs and the patient status, as we know that, you have, of course, as we all know, pancuronium is almost like outdated. We may actually use cisatracurium, which I just shared with you. Again, that is for initial 48 to 72 hours. I don't think there could be a specific reason of using atracurium, especially in COVID-19. There is no such, I don't think there is any data on that. But then, the standard selection of the paralytic agents can be either a cisatracurium or a plain atracurium, and in few cases, even vecuronium if you don't have an organ failure patient. So I'm not very sure of any data of COVID-19 patient and atracurium. So Dr. Vijay, if you want to add something.
No, that's fine. I think it's more of a personal preference, number one.
Yeah.
Number two, the incidence of histamine release is not as common
yeah.
as in the books. So yeah, you could use any one of them. Yes. Certainly taking into consideration if somebody has got multiple organ involvement.
Yes.
How long can we use dexmedetomidine for sedation?
Yeah, so I think as we know that dexmedetomidine is also a short acting agent, and mind you, you know, even the cost can matter. So in few situations where you can actually you know, use it as a loading dose followed by you know, an infusion for initial 2 or 3 days, and then actually you can use boluses. In fact, it is said that till extubations or till weaning you can use it. So I think there is no such time period or a fixed duration as such, but then we can actually tighten. You while peri period more, and in between you can actually switch over to midazolam or a benzodiazepine infusion whenever the patient needs long term ventilation. I think it can be a mix and match rather than one particular agent.
So we have like 5 more minutes to go. We have one question which says, do we need dose adjustment when using midazolam and fentanyl together? Well, you certainly need to have your doses right, whether you want analgesia more or sedation more, which is your requirement at that point of time. And I will say most of the time, if analgesia is properly done, you do not require sedation.
Yeah, I know.
But you may only require a very small amount of sedation. Yeah. So if a patient is well taken care of his pain, he will continue to collaborate and cooperate with you in terms of ventilation, in terms of other procedures or positioning and everything. So yes, you may have to adjust your doses if you're using both.
Right. So always remember this principle of analgesia first, sedation. So that, as Dr. Vijay correctly said, that if you have a very good dose of analgesia, you may not actually, you may need a midazolam in a very least or very meager doses.